Greetings. My name is Joshua Bynes, and I'm the Industry Foresight Lead within the Corporate Strategy Organization at the Bonneville Power Administration. The following presentation is part two of a seven-part video series focused on exploring the long-term electric power industry landscape. If you haven't already, please take a few minutes to view the introduction to the series for some valuable context. Hopefully, you'll find the time spent viewing this video to be valuable. Please feel free to send me an email with any feedback. Enjoy. Salmon recovery efforts will be challenged by changing ocean conditions and warmer fresh water. And here I just want to point out first that, you know, since the 1990s, following some legal action, the Bonneville Power Administration was forced to start investing heavily into salmon recovery on the heels of the first listings of salmon under the Endangered Species Act in 1991. And since then, we have invested probably more money than any organization ever in an Endangered Species Act-based recovery effort, and we've essentially doubled the amount of salmon-spawning habitat in the Columbia River system since the time that the hydro system was done being built. Now, that said, over the last 20 years, a majority of that work was done at a time when we had really good ocean conditions in it. Because of it, a strong wind at our back. Unfortunately, that's about ready to shift. And in particular, what we're looking at is the likelihood of the Pacific Decadal Oscillation, sometimes called the Interdecadal Oscillation, shifting from cold to warm. Now, just a little background on what the Pacific Decadal Oscillation is. This is similar to El Nino and La Nina. It's referring to an oscillation of the surface water temperatures or near surface water temperatures in the Pacific Ocean straying above or below its norm. And while the El Nino-La Nina cycle typically occurs on like a three-year cycle, you know, give or take, the Pacific Decadal Oscillation occurs on a decadal span, just like the title would make it sound. Although in the last couple decades, it seems as though it may be quickening, but we don't have enough data in yet, and there's folks having arguments about that in the scientific literature. But basically, what we see in the decadal oscillation is a strong correlation between the cool and the warm cycles and the effects that that has on salmon returning to the Columbia River system. So when the decadal oscillation is in a cool cycle, what we can expect is that it's actually, you know, pretty good for salmon returning to California, Oregon, and Washington. Not very good up in Alaska. But when it shifts into a warm cycle, then it has the inverse effect, and it's pretty good for the salmon returning to Alaska. It has a really negative impact on salmon that are returning to Washington, Oregon, and California. And so you can see here, since the late 1990s, we've been primarily in a cool cycle, and that's had a pretty good effect on the salmon recovery efforts that have also been put into place, you know, adding to this uptick in survival of returning salmon. Scientists are predicting that we're going to shift into another warm cycle at some point in the 2020s. There's a couple scientists out there that are already arguing in their academic papers that we have already shifted into a warm cycle. And so that does not bode well for salmon recovery efforts. Unfortunately, it's not the only headwind that salmon are going to be facing out in the oceans. As our civilization pumps carbon into the atmosphere, you know, roughly a third of that carbon is absorbed by plants on land. A third of it goes into the atmosphere, and a third of it goes into the ocean. As that carbon is moved into the ocean, into that sink, it chemically mixes and creates carbonic acid, which is very rough on shellfish. You know, shellfish pull calcium out of the water in order to form their shells. As acidity levels increase, it gets harder for them to actually form their shells. And as the acidity level hits certain high amounts, it can actually start dissolving those shells as well. And for reasons that are being studied right now, the northern Pacific is intensifying in acidity at rates much higher than many other places around the rest of the world, to the point where we're already experiencing, you know, acidity levels in the northern Pacific that much of the rest of the world is not going to start experiencing till the latter portions of the century. Oregon State University completed a study over this past summer where they found there to be a correlation between these zones of high acidity along the Pacific coast corresponding to areas of cold water upwelling And I think their theory is that they're putting together now is that the cold water can become more acidic than warmer water. Those areas also seem to be staying fairly constant and not shifting around so much, at least from year to year. Although we keep in mind that their study, I think, has only been unfolding for about 3 years. So it's a little early to come to any like huge conclusions about that. But there are universities and organizations that are studying this. Unfortunately, even if our civilization stopped putting carbon into the atmosphere and we stopped increasing the acidity of the oceans through creation of more carbonic acid in the ocean water, this is a condition that we're going to be stuck with for hundreds, maybe thousands of years. It's not something that we can reverse. And so it's creating conditions that are going to be tough on salmon. I mean, when you think about that, you know, when juvenile salmon get out to the oceans, they rely on shellfish food stocks like copepods and pteropods in particular. And so what scientists are projecting is that the juveniles will get out to the oceans, their food stocks are going to be pinched, and so they'll be growing more slowly at the same time that other species' food stocks are similarly pinched and are likely to shift their predation onto those juvenile salmon. So species like herring and mackerel, for example, are likely to shift their predation onto those juvenile salmon. So we're expecting to see salmon getting this kind of double punch to the gut when they get out there into the ocean. Unfortunately, that's not the only headwind that they're going to be seeing out there. So on top of the Pacific Decadal Oscillation, on top of acidification, the heat content of the oceans is also rising. And along with it, and this is just a quick visual to show heat content rising in all the oceans of the world. And associated with this is, as the heat levels are rising, oxygen levels in the oceans are also declining. And when you look at this visual, the black areas are just areas where there's no data, and the blue areas are areas where the ocean levels of oxygen are declining. And you can see that in the northern Pacific, it's not looking especially great. What the heat content and the deoxygenation of the ocean is really driving is species migration, which can have a lot of effects across ecosystems that are not yet fully understood. There's a lot of scientists tracking this. In future installments of this, as I learn more, I'll pass it on. I know that's a lot of, you know, really bad news. There's, you know, no way around it. Ocean health right now is looking pretty terrible. Salmon are going to have to be dealing with that, you know, and when you put that into the context of higher outside air temperatures over land, it's a situation where we end up with really hot, dry summers. That's just going to make bad situations even worse. It's really a threat multiplier for when things are already tough.